rest. We left them behind on deck, praying for us.
There had been warnings throughout 1941, but the commanders in Pearl Harbor didn't believe the Japanese would dare attack. A radar operator who saw the wave of aircraft on his screen was told not to worry. They must be American. When the Japanese struck, everyone thought it was an exercise.
We actually saw the planes fly right over us, which is about, less than 100 feet above us. Did we wave to the pilot? We're waving at the pilot. He didn't wave back, by the way. He did not wave back.
By chance, I spotted a large battleship just below us, so I dived down onto it and released my bomb. We skimmed away over Ford Island at an altitude of 30 meters. I tried hard not to kill our speed.
I can remember running up topside, and they're saying the Japs are attacking, the Japs are attacking. And I'm thinking, oh, sure, you know.
At 8:10 a.m., a bomb struck the battleship Arizona.
The loudest noise I've ever heard in my life. It was awesome. It happened so fast. I would say she sank in, I'd say, maybe 2 minutes, 3 minutes.
Over 1,100 men were dead or dying, trapped below decks.
We started strafing. And oh, how terrifying the anti-aircraft fire was. Shells like lollipops buzzed up towards me and split right before my eyes, just missing me.
The destroyer Shaw took a direct hit from a dive bomber. On 1010 Pier, the mine layer Oglala slowly rolled over. The Japanese left 2,500 dead and a host of scorched and dazed young men.
We took one hit. It took all the skin off my face, off my arms, off my legs. So the big problem was the burns, keeping me alive because of the burns. But we thought we were tough, invincible. We weren't.
The Japanese hit other U.S. Pacific bases, including the Philippines. The idea was to force isolationist America to the negotiating table. But America was in no mood for isolation or talk.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. No matter how long it may take us to overcome this premeditated invasion, the American people in their righteous might will win through to absolute victory.
Appearances at Pearl Harbor were deceptive. Six of the eight battleships were eventually raised and fought again. The aircraft carriers were all safe. American industrial might would massively expand her Pacific fleet.
I knew we were going to lose. So my mind was always on what Japan was going to do after her defeat. Someone at my level in the foreign ministry wouldn't be much good if he couldn't foresee the outcome of the war. Of course we were going to lose. But by then, it was too late to turn back.
Sixty years on, oil still bubbles up from the Arizona's tanks. The treachery of the attack fueled American revenge. By the end of the war, said one admiral, Japanese would only be spoken in hell.
To be perfectly honest, I wanted to kill Japs because they had bombed Pearl Harbor.
We became completely and totally and unabashedly anti-Japanese.
It was like you were having an argument with a man and suddenly he slapped you three times rapidly across the face. You can't wait for the fourth slap.
After Britain's two lonely years, Winston Churchill described Pearl Harbor as a blessing for bringing America into the war. And even as the Arizona was sinking, Britain was fighting Japan on the ground, hand to hand.
We didn't think that the Japanese would take on the British, let alone the Americans, but they did.
An hour before their planes hit Pearl Harbor, the Japanese invaded Malaya. One of these Japanese soldiers clambering down the ropes into the landing craft was Masao Maeda.
I wasn't really nervous. I was rather confident because ours was seen as a crack regiment. We young soldiers were raring to go and fight in places like the South Sea and so on. We didn't think it would be an enormous war.
The Japanese were outnumbered by the British in Malaya, but steadily overwhelmed them with aggressive tactics and superior equipment. The Royal Navy sent its new battleship, Prince of Wales, and the battlecruiser Repulse. But 3 days into the Pacific War, both were sunk by the Japanese Air Force. In all the war, said Churchill, I never received a more direct shock.
I mean, we just didn't believe it. It was impossible to believe. But there it was. And for the first time, one suddenly realized that one was up against a first-class power.
The Japs, they were the rulers of the sky. Our blokes went up there, the RAF, and the Japs just made rings around them. Poor sods just got wiped out as they went up. They went up, never came back.
They said that tanks could not be used in Malaya, and they came down with loads of tanks, and all we had against them was armoured cars. They were going in against the tanks and they were blowing to bits.
So we had the tanks to put up with, the Air Force, their Air Force, and the Japanese Navy around the place. So it began to be a one-way trip all the way down.
A British soldier is equal to 10 Japanese, one squaddie said. But unfortunately, there are 11 Japanese. A cartoon in Punch, mid-January 1942, dismissed the Japanese as monkeys, pecking down trouble for themselves. The truth was, they were the masters in the jungle and in Malaya.
We were absolutely obedient to any order to charge or attack. We did what we were told. We really didn't worry about our own lives.
They worried even less about the lives of soldiers they captured. Accounts of atrocities soon filtered out of the jungle.
There was 12 Argyles taken, and the Japanese tied them up with barbed wire and had bayonet practice on them. And only one survived.